Welcome everybody to this edition of the Google Analytics 4 Masterclass, improving your marketing efforts and reaching your business goals. There's a lot of FUD about GA4 right now. Someone used that the other day, I love it. About, you know, what is GA4? Is it ready? How do you use it? And why do I care? So with that, next page. I'm your host, and Jay will walk you through setting the scene, use cases, and some Q&A. Again, welcome to all of our friends, our clients, the broader family, our prospects will be clients soon, and anybody else. Again, we're here to be your support. There's a lot of unknown, and again, really excited to walk you through why you should care. Jade?
Cool. Thank you. So in our webinar today, we're really going to be focusing on the key GA4 use cases and not going over the platform or the UI in detail or really talk too much about the differences of GA4 and UA. Our goal today is to really excite you about GA4 and get you in a position where you're able to use it really well and make an impact on your business. So if you would like more information about the platform and the navigation and the differences between GA4 and UA, please feel free to reach out to us after the webinar, and we'll be more than happy to give you a walkthrough. So as we all know, and the reason that we're here today is that Google has announced the sunset date of Google Analytics Universal. For free users, so anyone on just UA and not GA360, the sunset date is now 3 months away. When we first released this webinar, it was 4 months away, and today it is now officially 3 months away. So the clock is really starting to tick. For next year, for GA360 users, it's the 1st of July. So if you are in the premium version, you do still have time, but that doesn't mean don't migrate over to GA4. Definitely start to plan that now if you haven't already. So what does a sunset date actually mean? It means that we're going to stop processing hits from these dates, and historic data will be stored for 6 months after the deprecation date. Just to note, in terms of that storage, it will be read-only, so there's definitely not going to be any ability to edit your UA properties or to make any changes. So really, the call to action right now is definitely upgrade if you haven't already, and if you need help doing so, please let us know. And some insider scoop from Google is that they're working on an automated solution to push historic data into BigQuery. We're not sure when that will be released, but in the meantime, we have actually built our own solution that does this. So again, if you're needing help, please reach out. So in terms of what the sunset date actually means in some more detail, so as I said, it will be read-only data for about 6 months after the deprecation date. Google has committed to giving nobody additional extensions. We've had people beg and ask, and the answer is always no, and it will stay that way. But most importantly, and what we're really happy to discuss today, is that GA4 is officially at use case parity with Universal, which means that it has a lot of the similar features that one would expect in Universal. And yes, we will definitely not ignore the fact that there are bugs in the platform and that people have a lot of frustrations with it. But for the most part, and I think we can all acknowledge for those of us that have used it, is that it's really come a long way for us. So what is it actually? It's the fourth version of Google Analytics, hence the name. It follows Firebase, which was launched in 2016, which was a product that kind of sat alongside Universal Analytics, so GA Universal. And basically what Firebase was designed to do was to track apps. So for those of you that are familiar with AppsFlyer, it's a Google equivalent of it. It's a free product and works super well in terms of tracking like your key events. And you can also do functionality like pushing notifications and all of that from your app through Firebase. But essentially the problem that we faced and what caused GA4 to come to life is that UA was really good at tracking websites. Firebase is really good at tracking apps, but we didn't have a product that could track both. And the way that the industry is moving, this became a really critical need. And that is why GA4 was born. On top of that, it was really designed to address four other areas. So cross-device tracking, similar to what I just mentioned, privacy regulations and updates, advanced data insights, and data activation. And we'll go through all of these in detail now. So as we all know, we're in a place in the industry and in our lives where we've been shown ads on all devices. So as a consumer, we know that when we're watching our smart TV, there's an ad often there. When we're on our mobiles, there's always ads. And when we're on our desktop, of course, there's always ads. And essentially what we're needing is a product that allows us as advertisers to track the entire user journey. And what GA4 has been built to do is to be able to scale to track all of these things. So right now, yes, it doesn't track smart TVs, but in the way that it's been built, it is definitely in a place where it could. Right now, it is just there to track your app and your web. And as I think a lot of us would know, it used to be called GA App and Web and has now since been called GA4. And in terms of the digital landscape, we really have started to experience a little bit of a paradigm shift where users have more than expected privacy and basically control over their data. What they've more than anything is demanded it. And because of this, platforms have updated. There's been browser regulations on third-party, browser restrictions on third-party cookies. Mobile operators have also started limiting the use of device identifiers. And most importantly, our regulators have also listened and spoken. So in the US, we deal with CCPA. In Europe, we are dealing with GDPR. And around the world, there's all different regulations. And really what these have done is forced us as advertisers to act and actually really rethink the way that we do everything. So GA4 has been built for a future that is consented, user first party and modeled, which is aligned to how we all need to be dealing with the future of measurement. As we all know and have discussed, regulatory changes, browser updates and user expectations have really impacted the world of measurement. And being able to have a privacy-centric measurement tool has become crucial. GA4 works super well with consent mode, which is a tool available in GTM. And because of this, we are able to control how data is collected and used in GA4 based on a user's consent. First-party data has always been important, and we all know this. We've all used it in our campaigns. It really works well from a remarketing perspective and also has a lot of website functionality. But more than ever, it's become super important with third-party cookies going away in the near future. GA4 has been built with best-in-class technology to basically allow us to collect our first-party data from our websites in a privacy-first manner that still allows us to derive insights from our data, even if a user opts out. So really what's happened is that it's been built in with modeled machine learning, where we are able to, basically, when a user opts out, we are able to model in the gaps in the data that is caused due to that opt-out. So based on these three points, it's really what is a very, very key game changer about GA4 and what makes it a lot better than some of the competitors is that it is really a privacy-first product that works both for consumers and for our advertisers as well. And in terms of advanced insights, GA4 is designed to help marketers break down silos and increase access to their data by providing both unsampled data, custom reporting, machine learning, as well as advanced attribution models across the interface. So I think one of the main frustrations we've been dealing with is that clients often say that the data in GA4 is not always unsampled, which was one of the key selling points. And what we found is for the most part that it is unsampled within the main reports. But I think for those of us that have actually played around with Explore, we found that it is often sampled over there. In terms of custom reporting, the whole UI can be easily edited and all the reports can be customized to produce reports that are similar to what you would expect to a data scientist to provide. In terms of machine learning, GA4 has machine learning baked into the interface, and this really allows us to model the data that is unconsented, as we spoke about, but also provide automated insights and generate predictive metrics that can be used to build predictive audiences for activation. And in terms of attribution, GA4 has data-driven attribution across the entire interface. And with GA360, this was available as a feature, but it actually wasn't something that we could actually report on across all the reports. And this is now available in GA4. Cool. So to summarize some of the main differences between GA4 and UA, this would be data ingestion, no more views, and additional platform integrations, as well as a difference in enterprise costs. So GA4 is designed with an event-based data collection model, which is designed for scalability across app and web. UA was always hit in session-based, and we'll get into that in a little bit more. GA4 has no more views. So for those of you that are an enterprise, you'll know that there's sub-properties available, but for GA4, you can only access the data via a property, which isn't really the end of the world because you can actually create multiple properties with different views and different filters for your different users. And then in terms of additional platform integrations, this is one of the biggest game changers for GA4. And really what this allows is for you to have integrations with the full GMP stack, and as well as BigQuery. And having an integration with BigQuery really opens up the doors to Google Cloud Platform. For those of you that aren't aware of what Google Cloud Platform is, it's often known as cloud. People refer to it as that. But really what it does is it unlocks the ability to activate on your data using different AI and machine learning tools that are available for almost anyone to use. And BigQuery is really the entryway in terms of having your data there. It allows you access into cloud because BigQuery is one of the cloud modules. And then in terms of enterprise costs, GA360 typically goes for around $120,000 a year in the US, whereas GA4 has an entry price of $50,000 annually. And this is because GA4 is based on events. So for bigger businesses, you would pay more for your high event volumes, but for smaller businesses and even medium-sized businesses, the cost generally does come in at around $50,000, which makes it a lot more affordable for most businesses as a product. Cool, so we have set the scene and we're going to move into some use cases. I just want to put a reminder for anyone that has questions to please put your questions in the chat box. But we're going to move into some pre-recorded use cases, which we were hoping not to do, but just to protect data, we needed to make sure that this was in place. So the first part is going to be around building audiences. Then we're going to move into some advanced analysis, which will be a live demo. And then we're going to look at integrating your platforms as well. So first use case is our audiences. So marketing has really moved into a place where brands who put their users at the forefront of their strategy and at the forefront of their approach are winning. This means considering the users at all times when thinking about everything from your messaging and your creatives, your targeting, your website experiences, your shipping and your delivery, and your entire offline experience. We need to make it as easy and as exciting as possible for users to complete your desired business objectives that drive your business. And the starting point of this exercise is knowing who your users are and how to reach them. And that is where GA4's Audience Builder can really help. So there are many signals available in GA4 that we can use to discover and speak to our users. And these include your Google signals, which give us useful demographic information about our users and who signed. And this is based on the users who actually signed into Google. So as we all know, Google is one of, like, they own YouTube, they own Gmail, they have a whole bunch of different products within the stack. And most people, including Maps, of course, and most people are often signed into that. So due to this ability for us to all be signed in, we're able to get this demographic data like age group, interest, and device type. Then we also have metrics, which give us a good idea of user behavior and can either be specific to a user's action or a recorded event based on what they're doing on your site. So the metrics can really be based on what they're currently doing right now, or it can look across their lifetime, which is a GA4 feature. So things that we can look at include event count, it can include lifetime sessions, and it can include purchase revenue. And events, which really form the basis of GA4, tell us about the actions of our users on the site. And this will be the actions like starting a session, adding an item to cart, or viewing a content on your website. And there's so many more. And this is where you can really get custom with GA4, is you can set up so many events in your platform that are very specific to your business, and then you can actually use them to create audiences. And lastly, your user scope data is data that's specific to your users. It still needs to be non-identifiable, so it needs to be private and anonymous data, but it's really information that will give us more information about who these users are. And it's customly tracked in your business. So this could include things like your user's country, their last purchase date, or potentially their loyalty membership tier, if that is something that you're able to track. So now we're going to change track a bit and speak about the marketing funnel, which I'm sure that you're all familiar with. Today, we're going to look at it from a first-party audience perspective, so it might be a little bit different from how you've looked at it before, and consider who we should be speaking to at each point. So for awareness, this is our largest addressable audience within our target demographic or geo. For consideration, this is our largest addressable audience where we have actually identified some intent. So we know that they potentially want to purchase from our brand. For conversion, this is the audience that we know that they have specific and recent intent. So they've definitely been on our site, they've shown interest, and we know that they're quite likely to purchase. And lastly, loyalty is our existing customer base who has one or more recent transactions or conversions, and we would like to re-engage. And if we dig a little bit deep into this, for awareness, we would want to speak to this user when they may be interested in your brand or product. at some point, and with the goal of reaching them with information about who our business is and ideally driving them to our site. For consideration, we want to speak to people who have shown interest in our products or the products of our competitors with the goal of driving repeat visits or engaging them again, potentially on a different and higher intent page of the website. For conversion, we want to speak to people who are in the process of purchasing our products and completing the desired action on our website with the goal of driving a conversion or driving a higher order value. And for loyalty, we want to speak to people who have previously purchased to get them to either purchase again or do something else on the website with the goal of driving user retention or increasing the lifetime value. And now back to GA4 and the GA4 Audience Builder. There are so many tactics that we can perform that would depend on your brand's level of maturity and the level of data connectivity. When we look at a nascent brand, we're talking about brands that basically have campaigns executed mainly using external data. So potentially you might be optimizing towards sales and you may be not pulling that sales data in, or you're potentially doing a lot of your media through siloed or direct buys with a limited link to your sales and your offline activity. Mature brands are those that execute campaigns dynamically and optimize towards a single customer or business outcome across channels. For each phase of the funnel, I'm going to start with the audience tactics that are most suitable for the nascent brands and move towards more advanced tactics that could be deployed as well. So let's look at awareness. So firstly, what we could do with awareness is target visitors that have engaged with the desired segment. So let's say you're an e-commerce brand and you're wanting to reach people that have potentially shown interest in dresses. Then you can basically segment an audience just for dresses and then create something similar. You then could also exclude your existing customers. So when you're in the awareness phase, you don't want to speak to people that have already bought. So most brands in this phase would exclude your existing customers, and I'll show you how to create an audience like this in GA4. And then you can also create a high value audience for expansion. So typically, and in the past, we've used similar audiences. Because of the changes in the industry, we now use expanded audiences or audiences for expansion. So in DV360, as an example, you can choose how expanded you want your audience, if you want it closer to the base or less close to the base, and that is now going to become the norm. For consideration, we can target users who showed purchase intent. So basically someone that's either been to the site and browsed something and then left. So just not necessarily gone full down the funnel, but just a little bit showed some level of intent. We can target users with a high purchase probability, and I'll show you how to do this just now. So using our predictive audiences. And then you can optimize bids towards users with specific intent as well. So you can actually create an event, which I'll show you, which you can actually use to optimize your campaigns. Then for conversion, you can target users within the moment purchase intent. So this is someone that's like super close to purchasing. They've added an item to cart. We know what the item is, and we want to create an audience of that. Then we could also target users with a high predicted revenue. So we know that they're going to purchase that they're about to purchase. And then what Google Analytics can do is, based on their behavior, basically predict whether the revenue from their purchase is going to be high or low. And then we can create an audience of the people that are predicted to have a higher revenue. And then we can also optimize our bids towards specific product buyers. So we can again create an audience of someone that's actually purchased a product, and then create an event off the audience, and then push the event to our campaigns for bid optimizations. In terms of loyalty, we need to target recently. We could target recently inactive customers. So you can basically target someone that was last on your site 14 days ago, as an example, and then retarget them with a message to get them back to your site. You could target customers with a high churn likelihood. So this is another predictive audience available in GA4. And basically create that, and then push them an offer potentially that could prevent them from churning. And lastly, you can also optimize your bids towards high lifetime value customers. So again, you can create that conversion point or that event from your audience, and you can do the same with predictive audiences, which is great. In GA4, there's so many ways to create audiences, and I'll demo some of these shortly. But these are some of the most popular options that are available on the platform. And I just want to point out a few of my favorite ones. So when comparing GA4 and the audience builder and UA's audience builder, although GA4 can sometimes take a little bit longer to prepare an audience and put one together because it's a lot more granular in a lot of ways, I find that because of that granularity, it just gives you so much better control over the audiences that you're creating, and also gives you the ability to drill down deeper into your events because of the parameters that exist. So, and when you're starting out with Audience Builder, I found that the template audiences is fantastic. It kind of resembles the UA Audience Builder in that it gives you metrics and dimensions that are familiar to you to work with. So if you're just starting out, like, and the build your own audience one feels very overwhelming, just try switch to the user template and you'll see how it will basically allow you to see how the actual audiences are built using common metrics and dimensions. And then the GA4 suggested audiences are also great. It takes a little bit of time for them to get better and for them to get more. But basically what it does is it looks at all of the data in your account and it will tell you which audiences they think would work in terms of your campaigns and all of that. And this will give you a really, really good selection of pre-built and predefined audiences for your brand. And then in terms of the conditions that can be applied out of the four on the right, my favorite one is probably the time the sequence one, because basically what that does is it allows you to build a sequence of events or conditions and then create an audience out of those. And what that does is from a data-driven perspective and a dynamic creative perspective, where we're wanting to speak to people based on certain conditions that they fulfilled, we are able to do that using this. So basically you can say that I want someone to view a product, add it to cart, and then within 5 minutes check out. You can set that as a sequence, and then basically you can create an audience of that person who potentially is very interested but then dropped off in the funnel. Cool. So now we're going to move over to the platform demo, which is going to mostly be in the presentation, but I'll be speaking through it. So audiences can be found in the admin section of the Audience Builder. Sorry, these got switched around. There we go. Of the Audience Builder. So if you click on the cog in the bottom left, you'll find this in your GA4 account. You just click that. It will open up the backend settings, and audiences is available over here in the property column. And then in terms of how the Audience Builder looks, it has a general section, which just has some audiences that are recommended to all people. So you'll see that it might have e-commerce, which maybe isn't relevant to you. So I have a section that's relevant to your industry. So this screenshot actually came from our website, that our GA4 account that we built for our GA4 training website that I'll be using for the demo later. So it was part of the internet and telecom section vertical. And then it also has the templates as well as predictive metrics. And then you can just click into any of these to enter the Audience Builder. Cool. So we are going to move into our first demo, which is looking at bucketing existing customers from web and app to either target them in the loyalty phase or exclude them from your prospecting and remarketing campaigns. So we'll start by naming the audience. So it's at the top over here. You give it a name and make it a clear name that you can, when you see it again, it makes sense. Then you select your purchase event for this one. So the event is purchase. I just typed in purchase, you select it. And then for most of the GA4 audiences, you need to set the event count greater than one, which means that it needs to count every time this event fires. So this is a little bit, greater than zero. So this is a little bit different from GA Universal. And then what we need to do here as well is if it is an app and web property, so it has both app and web, you need to do the same just for app. And there we go, sets are greater than zero. You wait for it to load. You check in the summary over here to make sure that the numbers make sense for your business and your brand. And then you click save. Then for the next one, we are going to show, create an audience of users that showed intent. And in this case, we're going to look at someone that showed intent for sneakers for an e-commerce brand within the last 7 days. So that's the audience we're going to be building. So over here, I'm selecting the view item event. So it's basically anyone that viewed an item on your landing page as an example. And then I set the event count again, greater than zero. And here at this point, I want it to be within the last 7 days. So I set the time period of 7 days and I want it to be the most recent time period. Then we want it to be that we select the parameter of the category against the view item event. So over here, you will select view item. Then we will select the event category, the item category of the parameter. And in this case, I wanted to say contain sneakers, but what I want to show over here is that you can also say is one of. So if you're wanting to say sneakers and socks and you're wanting to target people that are interested in both, you can say is one of and then have both available there. But in this case, you want to say contain sneakers. Then you'll see the audience size will change. It's only now relevant for sneakers, and then you save. And then now for a really cool feature of GA4, I've just opened this up a bit, but essentially what you do, once you create your audience, so the audience, this is our sneakers audience, what you can do over here is click this create new against audience trigger. And essentially that what that does is it allows you to create an event. So in this case, if we're wanting to create a bid optimization like option for our campaigns, and we're wanting to optimize towards people that did show intent in sneakers in this example, what we can do is create the trigger. And then what it will do is create a custom event that you can then convert into a conversion and then share with Google Ads. So over here, I've just named it sneaker interest. As I said, log an additional event. And then basically that is an event that you can now optimize towards, which I think is a super cool feature of GA4. And then the last demo in terms of audiences for today is purchase probability. So I'm just going to start this one again. So basically for this, we are able to create purchase probabilities. We are able to do churns. So if we go over here, you can see all the different options. So you can see likely to purchase in 7 days, predicted 28 top day spenders, 7 day churning purchases. So there's so many different options that you can select. For this one, we're going to do likely to purchase in 7 days. And all you need to do is select it. It comes default with a 90th percentile purchase probability. If you're wanting to target a bigger audience with a potential lower probability, all you need to do is just change that 90. Let's say we want to make it 80. And you will see that your audience will grow. And then you'll see that this 179,000 audiences is going to become 363,000 users in this audience. Again, you can create that trigger and then optimize towards people that are likely to purchase within 7 days. And yeah, that is on that audiences. So now we're going to, before we continue, I really want to remind you to please log your questions in the question box. We are definitely keen to have a very, very engaging Q&A, so please do that. But now I'm going to move over to an advanced analysis use case. So this is how GA Universal is currently structured from a hit to session to user level. So really how GA Universal works is that everything is collected as hits and you get different types of hits. So you can get a page view hit, you can get an event hit, you can get a transaction hit, and they're all essentially called hits. The hits are then rolled up into sessions and the sessions are then rolled up into users. And once you're, what this causes is a scoping issue. So for those of us that are very familiar with Universal Analytics, you'll know that often when you're trying to mix scopes, like let's say you're trying to mix like users and sessions or users and e-commerce, whatever it is, sometimes you get an error, especially in the custom reports. And that kind of limits the type of analysis that you can do. The great thing about GA4 is that everything is really around events and parameters. So everything you collect is an event, and every event can have up to, 25 parameters. You also get user properties, which is essentially like your user type metric, but those are also collected as events from like a basic level. And all of these roll up into users. And what this means is that when you're trying to build reports, you are able to mix and match as many metrics and dimensions as you want based on what you've set up in your property. So it really does make things a lot easier. Cool. So what I'm going to do now is switch over to the demo. For this demo, I'll be using our GA4 trading paths property. That is a property we've built from a website that we have that has GA4 trainings. Just for some context, in terms of the data we'll be looking at, the website has the ability to select different training paths for different types of users. And those include one for data analysts, one for practitioners, so people that actually use the platform, and then another one for campaign managers. As you can see, it's a really low volume website. It's something that we mostly use internally. and share very, very infrequently. So it has low volume. But what it will allow us to do is use the explore reports, which I'm going to navigate to now. So the explore reports are over here. If you pop out the sidebar, it's under explore. I've pre-built some reports that I'm going to show, and they are over here. Just to go back one step, just to show you the interface, you can see that there's all different templates that are available here. And you can explore the template gallery and see all the tools that are there. There'll also be different tools available for different reports available for different industries too. So over here is all the default ones that are available. And what we're going to do is use this one that I've pre-built, which I did using a blank report. So the first report we're going to go through is the all users report of. The first report we're going to go through is the free form report. And this report can be done with a table, a donut chart that I've used, a line chart, scatter plots, and all of it. And it's basically the equivalent of just the custom report builder in GA Universal. In this report right now, I've gotten all users broken out by the first medium that brought them to the website. So over here, we've got email, organic, and direct. And what I want to show now is how you can actually side by side compare different segments. So I've built a segment of registrants of people that have actually registered, and I'm going to show you how it's been built. So I've done it where the event register has an event count greater than zero. So we've set up an event for every time anyone registers for the website. And in this date range, it is, we've got 34 that of these event counts. And we've got it there now equal to zero set as a segment. I'm going to move the segment in as a comparison. So it's drag and drop. And over here, you can see the difference between people that have come direct. So most of our registrants are direct users, and we have organic and email. So you can see a side by side, and you can see as I highlight, it highlights the equivalent in the comparison, which is great. One really cool thing about the Explore tool is that it not only allows you to analyze data, but it also allows you to activate data. So let's say we're wanting to create an audience of people that have registered and come direct to the site. We can right click on the segment. We can say create segment from selection. And essentially what we'll get over here is a pre-built rule of register with event count greater than zero. And the first medium exactly matches none. And you can see that there are 29 people in the segment and 92 sessions that are linked to this. Then if you're wanting to turn this into an audience, you just select build audience and then you say save and publish. For the next report, we are going to look at a funnel. So this is a pre-built funnel again, which I've set up the steps over here and I'll show you how they've been set up. So first we have page title containing GA4 training incubator. So this is basically our homepage of the website. So it's showing anyone that has visited the site. Then we have the sign up page, which is our second page, and the page title contains sign up. And the third one is we have the page title containing data analyst for the choose data analyst path. And that's just the page path that we have selected for that. Over here, you can see how people are moving between the steps, and you can see how many people are abandoning it, and as well as what is the completion rate between steps. So this 55.7% is the amount of people that completed step one and moved to step two, and then this would be step two to step three for completion rate. And then for abandonment, it's basically the opposite of that is people that have actually left at that point in the funnel. If we are wanting to create an audience of people that have abandoned, you can right click over here and then say create segment from abandonments. So it's basically right clicking on the abandonment section. Create segment from abandonments. And you can see that the page rule is built out. Sorry, the audience rule is built out. Again, you say build audience and you can save and publish. You'll see that everything is pre-named as well. Then what you can also do is break it down. So as I said, it's a low volume site. So I'm going to use a dimension that will work, and this will be town and city. And we can basically see per city how different people move through the funnel. And again, if you're wanting to, let's say, target the people that abandon the funnel at the visit site between visit sites and sign up, you can just right click on abandoners over here and then create segment from abandonments. And you'll see that now the rule has been adapted to include town or city exactly matches Cape Town. For the next one is the segment overlap. This is much more useful if we had more data, and the segments I know that we've created are not that useful for insight purposes, but you can definitely get, once you play around with your own data and also with data that you're more familiar with, you'll be able to see the value of this. What this is designed for is allowing for creating of niche audiences, as well as seeing how different segments are working together. So over here, we've got Google devices. We have set the device category equal to Google. So over here, you can go to edit and then edit segment and the device brand. So it's any device that contains Google. And then we have the same for Apple. So the device brand contains Apple and then anyone that went via desktop. To create these segments, I actually used the templates over here of technology, and then you'll see device brand equals or contains Apple, Google, Microsoft, and then the device category contains desktop or mobile. So that's how I built that, and you'll see that this actually resembles more the UA interface that we all used to, as opposed to the custom segment builder. So over here, you can actually build any segments you want for comparison. So you can go as detailed or as top level as you need. But it's really easy to swap out segments. So let's say we're wanting to see people that were on a Google device and a desktop and registered for the site. We can do that. And we can see that 16 of the active users registered on a Google device, 32 registered on a desktop, and 2 of them registered on either a desktop or a Google device, which means it could be Apple or Microsoft as other options. Over here, you can see the different rules. So it will be whether it was a desktop or Google device as part of the flow, whether it was Google only or registrants only or desktop only. And then you can also see the combination of all three as well. So you can either play around by highlighting the segments over here, or you can actually do it within this data over here. Again, you can break it down. So let's say we break it down into town or city. You can see over there that it's now more granular. So let's say we're wanting to create an audience of active users that were on desktop and they registered and they're from Cape Town. We right click, create segment from selection. And there you go, is your rule. And then of course you can also do it over here by right clicking, create segment from selection, and same principle. So yeah, that is a demo of the Explore tool. Highly recommend that you do go play around with it and build your own reports and your own audiences from it. It's fun to do, and it also really allows you to dive really deep into your data. And that's only 3 examples that are out of many that are available. Cool. Now we are going to switch back to our slides. Again, any questions, please put them in the chat and we will be sure to answer them. So the last one that we're going to look at is platform integrations. And this is a great benefit of GA4. As I said, the whole GMP stack is available within GA4. And for those of you that aren't aware of what the GMP stack is and keep wondering why I keep saying GMP, it's essentially your DV360, which is your display module in the stack. It's a very, very good and advanced way of reaching a lot of users in a complex and strategic way. It's a great platform within the stack from a display perspective. It allows you to do both display and YouTube in one place. Campaign Manager is the ad trafficking tool within the stack. SA360 is the search tool within the stack, and it basically allows you to pull all your engines into one place. So if you're running Bing and you're running Google Ads, SA360 allows you to basically manage both within the same place. Microsoft Ads and Google Ads. It also integrates with Salesforce, which is available in GA360, but not available in UA free. So Salesforce is coming. It's not here yet, but it will be here hopefully at the end of the year. Of course, like as I said, it integrates Firebase because of the app component of it. Google Ads is standard, which is also already in UA. Optimize, which is being deprecated in September this year, does integrate at the moment with GA4. So does Google Ad Manager. So for those of you that use GAM, it is also available. And then BigQuery is available too, as I said. And so what does this really allow? So basically, one of the better things about GA4 compared to UA is that when you create audiences and when you create conversions within the platform and your platforms are linked, the audiences and the conversions automatically sync to any of your marketing platforms. And I'm sure I'm not the only person that found it very annoying when you created an audience that you had to select like the box and tick each platform that you wanted to send your audience to in UA. So that functionality isn't an issue anymore. Everything gets synced to all your platforms. So whether you're wanting it in display or you're wanting it in search or you're wanting it in Google Ads, it will be available when you need it. The one thing I need to call out is that SA360 does have a new interface. So similar to GA4 and UA, there's been a relaunch of the interface. And in order to make use of the GA4 benefits in SA360, if you use the product, you will need to upgrade to the new experience and the new interface to do that. But otherwise, really what it does is it will open up all of your conversion events and all of your audiences and either allow you to do custom bidding, so use bidding algorithms, which is specific to DV360, or actually just use your GA4 conversion point as your conversion point in your campaign, which is the case within Google Ads. With Firebase, what's really cool if you have an app is that you can actually use the audiences that you create to do push notifications, to do in-app messaging, to do cloud messaging, A/B testing, as well as app personalization. So all of those features do exist in Firebase, and they all will feed off these exact same audiences that we've been speaking about building, which really adds a lot of benefits and personalization to what you can do on your app as well. And then just once your platforms are linked, you'll have so many capabilities opened up within your platforms. As I mentioned, all of the audiences and the conversion points created in GA4 will become available on the platforms. And once they're there, what you'll be able to do is unlock auto bidding with GA4 conversions, which will basically increase your efficiencies and allow you to optimize your campaigns to very clear and designed objectives. You'll be able to report on your campaigns and optimize towards data-driven conversions, which will allow you to optimize the campaigns based on how they're performing within the entire media mix. And then also unlock engaged view conversions, which will allow you to reach users who either view your in-stream videos and then go to your site. So basically, anyone that sees a YouTube ad and goes to your site without necessarily clicking through, that type of information will become available in GA4. And lastly, you'll be able to remarket to users across the GMP stack. And this is something you could do in GA360, but not in UA, because the GMP integrations weren't in UA. But because of GA4, they're now available free for everyone. And this means that you can now remarket to a user who engaged on your search ads with an appropriate message in your display campaigns. And then just one more quick demo. Now I'm going to demo the platform integrations, and I'll also show you where to find the audience builder and events and conversions in the back end. So first you go to admin, so you pop out the sidebar and click admin. Product additions can be done, product linking can be done in the back end in the property settings. Product linking can be done in the back end in the property settings. So what we'll do now is test adding Google Ads. I'm not going to complete the addition because it will expose account names that we have access to. So I'll just show you how it's done. So you click link. I'm just going to go back. You click link. You say choose Google Ads account. You select it, then you select the account that you're wanting to add. You configure the settings, which is a few boxes to tick, and then you review and you submit, and it will be linked. At this point, all of your audiences and your conversions will then get shared to Google Ads, and you'll have access to them for bidding and audience targeting as well. The great thing, as I said, about Google Analytics is that your audiences and your conversions will be shared to your platforms that you link them to automatically, so you won't need to go and add in audiences manually one by one as you did have to do in UA, and all your conversions that are selected will be sent. these are all of the different all the different properties that are available, all the different products that are linked that are available for. These are all of the different products that are linked that are available for GA4 at this point. Salesforce is coming as part of the pipeline, and so is Campaign Manager. If you are wanting to view your audiences, and the audience builder can be found over here under audiences. And then you can see when you select create new audiences, you can see all the different audiences that are available for general, for everyone. This will be a segment that is specific to your vertical and that GA4 basically recommend for you. These are the templates that I showed earlier and the predictive audiences that will be available if you have enough volume in your account. In terms of events, you can find all the events that you set up in your account over here. You could also download them as a CSV, which is really useful. And if you're wanting to turn an event into a conversion, all you have to do is just toggle over here and it will become a conversion and be available under conversions, which is here, and it will be sent to your UA account. These are just pre-set up as a test, but not required at all for this property, but they are available over here, as you can see. So I'm now going to switch back and we are going to move into Q&A.
Great, thank you. I will read the questions and everyone please keep them coming. So the first one is, I understand Google's ability to view a logged in user across Google platforms. How would you address the awareness that is happening outside of the Google ecosystem, e.g. Meta, where most of us spend a lot of time and dollars? So where does other platforms besides Google fit in?
So the platforms, the outside of Google platforms are generally tracked with UTMs. So whenever you're setting up your marketing campaigns, you need to have a very good UTM convention. And basically all activity that is tracked with a UTM. So for those of you that aren't aware, so it would be like UTM underscore campaign or UTM underscore source or medium. Those are what allows you to track traffic in GA4. So if you're wanting to have all of your data consolidated in one place, you need to use those UTMs and the data will become available in GA4. What will be missing, which will be available in your Google platforms, is your view through data. So with UTMs, you can only really track a click, but at least you'll be able to see people getting to your site from those different platforms.
Okay. So these audiences that you have shown, So these are audiences that have shown interest based on the data specifically on our website or in general.
Sorry, can we repeat that?
So these are audiences that have shown interest based on the data specifically.
Yes.
Or on our website or in general.
So it is data based on your website, but it can also be data based on your app if that is in there, if your app is tracked.
What are some potential pitfalls that businesses should be aware of when we are migrating to GA4, and how can we avoid these?
So the main pitfall is not really understanding the GA4 data structure and kind of oversimplifying the tags. So from a UA event perspective, it's really easy to set up events, and the event category action label structure makes it very, very simple to set up events. With GA4, there's a lot of complexities that can lead to issues like cardinality, data missing, gaps in data, and all of that. And also, if you set up consent manager and consent mode incorrectly, it also kind of skews your data. So I'd say the biggest pitfall is oversimplifying it and treating GA4 as you would UA. There is actually setting up the initial platform is easy, and that's not the problem. It's actually setting it up well in terms of the additional events. And we've seen a lot of brands really completely oversimplify the setup, and then as a result, see huge gaps in the data.
And then can you also add, if people have GA360 across their accounts, but also don't upgrade them, what happens?
Oh, yes. So basically, if you're moving over to the GA4 license, you have to keep your GA360 properties upgraded, because once you move over, you're only able to upgrade GA4. So this is something we discovered recently. is that, yeah, you can upgrade any property to GA4 on the new GA4 license. But if you have a GA360 property and you haven't upgraded it yet and you get your GA4 license, you do not have the option to upgrade. But if you do upgrade it and you move over with it upgraded, you'll keep your GA360 property as it was in its upgraded form.
Thanks. What are the first things you look for in a Universal N account before migrating to GA4?
What we look for is your event structure. So we look at what you're currently tracking in UA. So we make sure that whatever is being tracked, we want to have parity as far as possible. So we make sure that your conversions are there, your events are there, and also custom dimensions and metrics. So that's basically the first thing. And then we also check for major tracking issues that we would want to avoid when we move over to GA4. The one thing to note is that GA4 and GA Universal will never really be the same. Like, we can't expect exactness in the data just because of the gaps in cookies and the modeling and everything that goes into GA4. So we do try to keep it as close as possible and kind of enhance it because we see it as an opportunity to restart your measurement once you move over to GA4. It's a really, really good refreshing opportunity for brands. But we do make sure that at least from a key goals, conversions, and events perspective that you're at parity.
Can you match import offline conversion data?
You can match or import offline conversion data, but in order to do that, you need to make sure that you have the right match keys. So let's say you're trying to import leads, sales from a lead. So what you will need to do is track your lead ID. You also ideally should be tracking a user ID, which is an anonymous identifier for every user. But importantly, you need to have a unique lead ID for every lead. And then in your offline data, you need to have that same lead ID and ideally the same user ID, and then use that as your join key. But the data import and the measurement protocol in GA4 is actually really impressive. It's something, yeah, we like it a lot. And you definitely can import offline conversion data.
Google Optimize is being discontinued and some of its functionalities will be moved into GA4. What functionalities will GA4 have from the go?
It is difficult to say right now. We don't know for sure, but definitely I think the option to report on A/B tests will be there, but that we can look into and get back to on.
Hey, any other questions, anybody, before we wrap up? Any questions? Great. Any questions, please send our way in this presentation. When you get it tomorrow, we'll include an email address. And again, please send us questions. Let's keep on going.
Cool. Let's move.
So again, anybody have any questions? We do audits, so we have a platform that does you know pretty good strong audits that give you best practice setups, use of events, data cleanliness, and platform integration. So again, if you'd like us to do that on your behalf, please send an email to techmaturity@incubated.com, and we will run that. There'll be a feedback form at the end, so please give your feedback. The only way we can get better is we measure it and incorporate your feedback. We will be, this is a series, as I started. It's the first of a series, but the next one will be the second one of the series. And the next one will be about advanced reporting and use cases. So this was very much a high level. The next one will be a little more geeking out on how do you do attribution, data import, basic query, BigQuery and Google Cloud use cases. And again, any feedback you have will incorporate into subsequent masterclasses. And then we have an event coming up shortly in April. You all will get an invite, The Art of the Chaos, Opportunity in Times of Change. Please register for that if you're interested. Again, a big thanks to everyone for joining. We're thrilled for you to be part of our family. Reach out if we can be helpful and have a brilliant day. Thank you so much.
Thank you.